So I'm Maurice Tomlinson. I'm a senior policy analyst with the Canadian HIV AIDS Legal Network, but my work concentrates on the Caribbean and eliminating homophobia and HIV, which contributes to the region having the second highest HIV prevalence rate in the world. And Jamaican men who have sex with men have an HIV prevalence rate of 33%, which is the highest in the Western Hemisphere, if not the world. And a lot of it has to do with what we're going to talk about today. So I've handed out some packages, which hopefully you all have, which summarize the work that the Canadian HIV AIDS Legal Network does, challenging this phenomenon of homophobia across the Caribbean. Now, I'm going to be talking about some of the cases that I've been involved in and that are ongoing, challenging homophobia. And the first question is, well, why did we start with legal challenges in Jamaica? Because the fact is, it may be true, as Martin Luther King said, that the law cannot change the heart, but it can restrain the heartless. So yes, a lot of what you saw yesterday in the abominable crime is not entirely linked to the existence of an anti-sodomy law, which by Caribbean standards is pretty modest. In Jamaica, it is only 10 years for same-gender intimacy. In Barbados, it's life in prison. In Trinidad, in 2012, they passed a law which threatens kids under the age of 18 with up to life imprisonment if they, kids, engage in same-gender intimacy. Okay, so we have some pretty draconian laws. Jamaica's is not the worst. I want to put that out there. But the law does serve as license for a lot of the attacks we have encountered, and we'll see that soon. So a quick overview, I'm sorry I have to be doing this, but the Offenses Against the Persons Act, as I said, provides up to 10 years in prison. In 2011, we updated the law by passing a new charter, which seeks to entrench the law and prevent it from being judicially challenged. So only Parliament can change it. But we also added a sex offender registry requirement. So if you are convicted under this law now, and this law means that even if you're in the privacy of your bedroom and you hold your partner's hand, that's called gross indecency, and you could be convicted. Once you are released, you must be registered as a sex offender. You must always carry a pass. And if you are without this pass, you'll be fined 1 million Jamaican, which is still about 10,000 US, plus 12 months in prison, right, for holding your partner's hand in the privacy of your bedroom. The law is linked to homophobic violence. The Inter-American Commission on Human Rights and the UN Special Rapporteur on Torture have made it very clear that the existence of these laws contribute to violence. We have seen where when Jamaican LGBT are attacked in their homes and the police go to rescue them, the society or the mobs will be upset. Like, why are you preventing us from doing the law's job? We are simply doing what the law says. These people can't be doing what they're doing. It's illegal. So we're simply carrying out, you know, mob justice. The law does provide a license. And in May 2014 of this year, we had a situation where two men were in the privacy of their bedroom. They were at home. And a group of thugs came and sprayed their house with bullets and killed them. And they walked away. And the community said the police will get no assistance in finding their killers because it was simply a fish kill, right? In Jamaica, fish is another derogatory term for gay, right? So the law does serve a purpose. In February 2016, our new prime minister says that there must be a referendum on decriminalizing sodomy. This is not going to be progressive or productive because the last time we did a poll, 91% of Jamaicans were in favor of the law. We have seen, however, some positive developments. For example, in August of 2015, we had the first Jamaica Pride, which was based in Kingston, and the mayor of Kingston actually attended and gave the keynote because she said that she's the mayor for all of Kingston. And in October 2015, we also had the first Montego Bay Pride, and you're all invited down for the second iteration. And Jonathan, I think I've just lost the thingy. Sorry. There we go. All right. So just need to swipe up. All right. So you're all invited down to the next iteration of Montego Bay Pride. And this is an image of Dwayne Jones, a 16-year-old trans youth who went to a party dressed as she identified. It was a public street dance. She had been kicked out of her home at 14 because her father couldn't deal with her gender nonconformity. And when Duane went to this street dance, a female member of Duane's church outed Duane to the mob. They turned on Duane, they stabbed, shot, ran over Duane with a car, and then threw her body into the bushes and went back to dance. Okay? And that was in 2013. There's been no arrests because the community says, you know, this is simply in accordance with the law. They're doing the law's job. Okay? This is how the media represent LGBT. This was last 2 weeks ago. This was one of the editorial cartoons in Jamaica Observer, a newspaper which is owned by the same people who own Sandals Resorts. They're known for very anti-gay caricatures, right? And this media representation is seen to be justified because of the law. We have recorded, the University of the West Indies did a research in 2011, which was the first time we did that, to identify the level of homophobia. And it was recorded in 2011 at nearly 82%. It has since been recorded again at nearly 91%. So there's then nearly a trend up, and it has been linked to, among other things, the agitation by evangelicals who claim that if we decriminalize, it's going to lead to marriage equality, as is in the States. So the marriage equality debate in the States is having repercussions in the Caribbean and elsewhere. Right? Now, for us as an HIV/AIDS organization, we are concerned because if you look at the graph that I just showed you, the level of homophobia correlates inversely to the level of HIV prevalence among men who have sex with men, which, as I said, is the highest in the Western Hemisphere, if not the world. Right? Because men are simply, gay men are driven underground, away from effective HIV prevention, treatment, and care interventions. So this is the last research which shows 91% of Jamaicans in support of the law. I'm going to go through these very quickly because I want to keep to my time, but the slides will be available for persons who want to mull on them and chew on them a bit. Right? We had two massive anti-gay demonstrations which have been organized by the evangelical extremists. The last one was November 2015 when the Prime Minister of Britain was visiting Jamaica. And because he had said at some CHOGM meeting, Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting, that, you know, there's going to be economic consequences for states that don't decriminalize. The evangelicals came out and they said, you know, he dare not, when he comes to Jamaica, suggest decriminalization because it's reverse colonialism, etc. So we have adopted, which is ironic, this British law as a form of our national identity. And any suggestion of getting rid of this British law, even when the Briton who gave it to us says get rid of it, we will not have any of it. It is now our law. And Britain, you were wrong to get rid of it. Okay? So it's a very interesting sociological discussion, which I will leave to some other people, some of the excellent people on the panel. So we had a massive anti-gay protest, as I said. Our Minister of Justice basically told me in conversation that, you know, unless we show him a poll where the level of homophobia is below 50%, there'll be no repeal of the anti-sodomy law. That was the former Minister of Justice. We now have a new one as of February. I have not had an opportunity to dialogue with him yet. But the previous Minister of Justice and the former Attorney General, they also said that at international conference, Jamaica respects the rights of all and there is no discrimination. Okay, even though we know that that's not exactly true when it comes to LGBT people. And the country will not bow to pressure to repeal the anti-sodomy law. Again, this nationalist rhetoric. And the police in Jamaica have an internal non-discrimination policy, which basically says on paper that they're not to discriminate in executing their jobs. But of course, we know that what's on paper doesn't get translated into practice. And in cases where we have gone to the police with victims of homophobic violence, the police have basically said to us, and we have them on tape saying this, we have to come with the names and addresses of the attackers when it's an LGBT violation. Okay, they're not going to just do a general investigation. When I reported my death threats for the work I do in relation to LGBT rights, the police officer said they hate gays, they make him sick. And I had to leave the station. Reported him to his boss. His boss said, well, those attitudes are unfortunate, but they won't change until the law changes. Reported him to the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, and that's when the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights issued the first ever precautionary measures for someone working on sexual orientation and gender identity issues in the Western Hemisphere. And that was in relation to my case. And since then, they've done several other precautionary measures on this issue. So why is Jamaica so homophobic? Well, our musicians and our pastors, I'm sorry to say, because our pastors imbibed a lot of the exported evangelical anti-gay rhetoric from people like Jimmy Swaggart, etc. And they basically preach this hate every Sunday or Saturday. And it started in the late 80s when they started losing the global war up north. So they drifted south, where it's warm. And this rhetoric then got absorbed by our musicians who all grew up in church, because in Jamaica it wasn't an option. Everybody had to go to church. So you listen to this hateful rhetoric, religious rhetoric, every weekend. And then they started performing what they knew. And so I'm glad we have two panelists who will talk about religion and music and how it interplays in Jamaica. But the musicians, their hate speech was heard on buses, in cars, etc. We're not a quiet society. So you hear that hate music Monday to Friday, and then on Saturday and Sunday, you hear hate preaching. So it creates a, you know, almost a perfect storm of homophobia. And we have, as I said, a law which underpins that, which I'll briefly go through. Section 76 provides up to 10 years in prison for any form of anal intercourse between men or women, men and men. But Section 77 only criminalizes attempted anal intercourse between two men. So that's when it becomes specific. And then Section 79 provides up to 2 years of prison with hard labor for gross indecency. And that includes two men holding hands in the privacy of their bedroom. Whatever is gross depends on the judge's interpretation. Okay? Now, Section 13.2 of the new charter seeks to save the law to preserve it from any constitutional challenge. As I said, the Sexual Offences Act of 2009, which came into force in 2011, added onto that a requirement to be registered as a sex offender and always carry a pass, etc., etc. So it's like, think of a scarlet letter. You get the idea. Now, in Jamaica, there's an ironic situation where if you work for the government, you actually are guaranteed non-discrimination on grounds of sexual orientation, because our civil service staff order provides that there should be non-discrimination on the grounds of sexual orientation if you work for the government. That was not put into our charter. So anybody else is subject to violations. It's an anomaly which we tried to fix, but we failed. Again, because the evangelicals, they heard, when they found out that the charter, the civil service staff order had slipped through, they redoubled their efforts and they made presentations to parliament and submissions that we can't bring equality because it's going to be the horrors of gay marriage and you know the usual rhetoric. And in 2011, we included the first ever ban on non-heterosexual relationships in our charter, right? Whether it's common law, civil law, we included a ban. And of course, that's not even something the local community, LGBT community, had been asking for, but it was in response to the situation in the States. So a newspaper in 2011 did this cartoon to show that in Jamaica, the Charter of Rights covers everybody except JFLAG. JFLAG is the Jamaica Forum for Lesbians, All Sexuals and Gays. So we're the only ones not covered by the Charter, or so we thought, right? What did we do in response? Well, we appealed to the Inter-American Human Rights System, where we thought was the only avenue because we didn't have legal redress domestically. And we got the first, as I said, precautionary measures issued on behalf of an LGBTI human rights defender. We got precautionary measures in relation to two petitioners who were challenging the Jamaican anti-sodomy law. We got a report in 2012 from the Inter-American Human Rights Commission, which spoke about the level of violence being attributable to the law. And we were allowed some thematic hearings on the level of homophobia. So we did get some response. Now the challenge is those are all recommendations. They're not binding on the Jamaican government, but it's good for, moral authority. And Jamaica doesn't like to be seen as a homophobic place. I've heard them say that specifically. Domestically, we've also launched some challenges. So I've had a matter before the Court of Appeal, the Supreme Court, and the Caribbean Court of Justice. And I like to use this image because that's my legal team, more or less. So I have this young Jamaican female lawyer and this old white male Briton, Lord Anthony Gifford. Lord Gifford is actually a British Earl. And he is he worked on the case that decriminalized sodomy in Northern Ireland. So he removed the last anti-sodomy law in the UK, right? He relocated to Jamaica, and so he's one of my counsel. We filed a petition, two petitions actually are there, one I'm involved in, before the Inter-American Commission. As you know, that system works very slowly. We filed it in 2011, we're still awaiting admissibility. So we don't even know if they will take up the case yet. And we filed a case challenging two TV stations that refused to air a tolerance ad calling for respect for the rights of gays. We lost at the domestic at the first instance, but it's now at the Court of Appeal. It was heard in February this year, and we're waiting the decision. And basically, although we lost, we did get a win because the court did say, the president of the panel said, even though the charter seems to not protect gays, it is to be assumed that all Jamaicans, including homosexuals, that's important that you reference us, are protected by the charter. So there's a little opening. If anybody knows how jurisprudence works, you have to build on these things. They don't happen overnight. And then I filed a case challenging Belize and Trinidad and Tobago because they banned the entry of homosexuals. And the decision was handed down yesterday by the Caribbean Court of Justice. So I won and I lost. So they didn't give me my my relief, which I was seeking, a declaration that the laws violate my rights. But they said, no, since you are able to come and go, and the government has never actually banned you, it's not a bar, but they've also said it is to be understood, and this is, again, important to get this in our jurisprudence, it is to be understood that homosexuals cannot be banned because they're not an undesirable person. So if I was to go and be turned back, I can bring up this thing and say, ha-ha, you know, this case says I cannot be banned, right? So you do, in jurisprudence, you know, you take what you can get. And it's ironic because in 2007, the Trinidad tried to ban Elton John from going to that country to perform in Tobago because they said that, the evangelicals said that if he came, all the people who are confused about their homosexuality would become gay. Hey, Jonathan. Is it up or down?
Press that one.
Oh, press that one first. Ah, there you go. All right, sorry. No. And then, so, you know, it came down yesterday, but I think we can take some nuggets out of it. So it says that gays cannot be banned from entering Belize and Trinidad, and the laws must be so interpreted, right? And they also refused to award costs. The government of Belize was asking that I pay their legal costs. The court said, no, that's not something. And now I've also challenged the Jamaican government in relation to the anti-sodomy law. I was a claimant, so I was the lawyer for the first claimant challenging the law. And then he left he withdrew the case because of threats to his life and his family. So I took over, so I became the claimant and found a new lawyer. Okay, so the ICHR petition, that's kind of the summary. I'm going to go through quick. File 2011 on behalf of two petitioners whose identities were suppressed, which is good because the Inter-American allows that because they were fearful for their lives. The American Convention on Human Rights is the basics instrument we're using to say that the law criminalizing same-gender intimacy violates the rights in the American Convention, including health. It's still pending admissibility. But the IACHR has suspended all hearings, or at least the next two, and controversies because of financial crisis. So now that I'm in Canada, I'm going to beg the Canadian government to please fund this this necessary body. And I'm very glad that we have a representative of the Inter-American Court here, because hopefully I can keep you employed, sir. Wish me luck. I'm going there this afternoon. And I'm going to, we've learned that the IACHR takes a long time. Will issue non-binding recommendations. Only four countries in the Caribbean recognize the jurisdiction of the Inter-American Commission, I believe. Only one recognizes the jurisdiction of the court, which is Barbados. And it does create it has some excellent jurisprudence, which I'm sure you'll hear about. But you have to first exhaust domestic remedies, which is always challenging when you can't find a claimant, because it's a small society and people don't want to be visible because of the impact on their lives. And as I've said, if you want to understand how challenging it is to bring cases, think of the smallest town you know, surrounded by a moat, and fill it with sharks. That's how some of the Caribbean territories are, because it's hard to get out and hard to come back in if you are an unnational and to get work. So people don't want to expose themselves. The TV case I've challenged, there's a link, you can look at it. It's a very innocuous thing. innocuous ad which calls for the respect for homosexuals, the TV station said if they air it, it would be violating the law which criminalizes same-gender intimacy, which it doesn't, because the law does not say, doesn't have me having sex. It has me saying I want Jamaicans to respect my rights as a gay man. The law criminalizes the act. It does not criminalize my orientation. Okay? But the TV stations, they won't air it. And the broadcasting regulator has said, well, the law actually isn't being breached, and the law, the ad should be aired, or can be aired. They didn't say it should be, can be aired. They've decided to ignore it. So the matter is before the Court of Appeal. Lessons learned. We need a national human rights instrument, because in Jamaica now, I can sue a private individual for a constitutional ban, sorry, constitutional breach of my rights. But that means every time someone breaches my rights, I have to bring them through a full constitutional case. Whereas if you had a national human rights instrument or institute or something of that sort, I could just bring an administrative claim. And we've created a horizontal application so that I no longer have to wait for a state to violate my right. I can sue a private individual for violating my right, but I still have to use the same process of suing the state, which is really too expensive. Our charter law needs development. It was the first case challenging the new charter, so thank you. All right, good. Quickly, I'll skip some others, something I was going to say. The constitutional challenge, the original claimant withdrew, as I said. We have 9 church groups have applied to be interested parties. They're basically relying on each other's affidavits, and they're saying that they need to be interested parties to, you know, bring their own full evidence and experts, etc. Because if we don't keep this law, it's going to lead to the extinction of mankind and, you know, the detriment of society. They've used some very extreme stuff. And in the court, when they made their allegations and submissions, the judge said, well, you know, some of these statements you're making are a bit far-fetched, aren't they? And the lawyer for one of these groups, who happens to be the former Attorney General of Jamaica, so they have senior powered people, he basically said, no, they might be far-fetched arguments, but we need to be in the case to prove them. Like, okay. It's kind of not how that works, but anyway. You don't waste the court's time with nonsense. The public defender has said she's... He said 4 minutes. Am I done?
No, you need to...
Okay, sorry. Public defender has applied to be in, but the AG is opposing her. The immigration challenge, as I said, I lost, but I still think we got some wins, because whereas the Trinidad lawyer said that we needed to keep the law to keep out terrorists, the court did say, no, you can't ban gays from coming into Trinidad and Belize, right? And some of the results we have seen. Right. We've seen some positive editorials by Jamaican newspapers supporting the repeal of the law. And we have learned that sometimes you have to lose forward. You have to lose some cases to get some critical principles. Arguments are recyclable in many cases. You have to prove harm at international courts, which is the challenge with the inter-American system. Someone has to be turned back before they prove that the law violates their rights, not the existence of the law. Okay? And we have the horizontal application, which requires us to have a national human rights instrument, because we can't be suing for every matter.